Okay, so I know there are a lot of people, participants today at this this seminar. So before I go on to pathology, I thought of sort of introducing you all to what pathology is and what you should know about yourself before choosing this specialty. So you have all seen these pictures, you know, you are used to these clinical doctors with the stethoscope, and they're all very, very well known to you. But I'm sure, you know, very few of you have seen a pathologist in real life, because we work behind the screens, we are not known to many people, but nevertheless, we are supposed to look at certain, you know, very small pieces, bits and pieces from here and there, or a little, you know, some blood or serum, and then give a diagnosis to the clinicians to manage the patients. An extremely challenging job. So who are we? We are actually the intelligence arms of the medical profession in civils. So we are behind the screens doing all the groundwork for the clinician to manage the patient. In other words, it's our command that the others perform. So if you want to be in that commanding position, I suggest that you join our team. But before you do that, I don't want any of y'all to be stuck in a career that you will repent for the rest of your life. So what are the important life skills that you should have to join this profession? It is very, very essential to identify your strengths. Now, surgery is a very, very popular career. But if you are not skilled in surgery, you will be a surgeon in paper only. Nobody will come to you. Word will get around that you're not a good surgeon. So do you want to be that? Same goes for every career, every profession. So you have to be very, very, very careful when you select your future career, because this is going to be the rest of your life till you retire. So be very careful. And today I will guide you how you should identify yourself, how you should look at your strengths when you, if you want to do a career in pathology. So if you know, if you are good at this, if you are good at, you know, looking at a few pieces here and there, and if you can look at that and complete the picture, right? Keyhole vision. If you have this ability, you should be a pathologist. If you are good at identifying objects in a maze of other things, you have a maze of other things, but you identify the culprit. So if you're good at such things, these are basic life skills that I want you to sit down and think before getting trapped in a profession that you don't like. If you are good at it, choose pathology. If you are good at identifying the obvious abnormal, you should do pathology. If you have a photographic memory, if you can remember various types of images, and when you see them again, you can correlate where it came from, the original, you should do pathology. If you're good at describing things, say we are all about descriptions of things. If you know, if you call an apple an apple, you know how to describe a square. You know about where it came from, whether it is from the skin, whether it's from the ear, what color is it, what shape is it, all those. That is what you'll be doing for the rest of your life, part of it. If you're good at prioritizing your possibilities, if you have a lot of possibilities, a lot of differential diagnoses, you have to give one to the clinician, at least the best one. So if you are good at doing that, if you are good at that decision-making in helping the clinician, otherwise you will not be looked upon as a good pathologist. So you have, this is a guidance to be good at what you choose, right? Everything else is there in the PGIM, in prospectus, in all the types of prospectus. It is this crucial decision of selecting the right field for you that we have to help you. If you are good at landmarks, if you remember, you've gone one place to a place before and you remember the landmarks, and when you go to that place again, if you remember the landmarks and be able to identify them, you should do pathology. If you're a good judge of character, now we deal with benign and malignant tumors day in and day out. So if you look at something and identify it as good or maybe benign tumor, that's a characteristic that you need to have. If you look at something bad and identify it as bad, you should do pathology. But you must do pathology if you see what is bad beneath a good face, or if you see what is good beneath a bad face. Some tumors look bizarre and we think, oh, it's very, very malignant. But actually, when we do further studies on it or further tests on it, it's not as bad, right? So these are essential characteristics that a pathologist should have. Decision-making, it is the most important characteristic that you should have in joining pathology. If your decisions have been swayed by others, if you always depend on others for your decisions, don't do pathology. Because then day in and day out, you'll have to depend on others. If you have done this, if you have gone through things without falling into pitfalls that the others have fallen, you should do pathology. Because pathology is all about falling into pitfalls day in and day out. And you've done this, you've done it without a problem. You've managed to encounter and go to the other side, you should do pathology. So those are the little things that you must know about yourself before you choose pathology. And if you choose pathology, what is the role of a pathologist? You're in the diagnostics, in prognostication, treatment, and also cause of death, doing autopsies. You're part of the multidisciplinary team. You're in management of the laboratory, quality control, management of the technologists. You're involved in teaching and research. So this is, in a nutshell, what you will be doing in the future. So what are the subspecialties? We have histopathology, you know all about it. It's the diagnosis of diseases, cancers, performing FNAs, performing pathological postmortems, and so on. Hematology deals with the diagnosis of blood diseases and management of bleeding disorders. And chemical pathology is performing various special enzyme assays, screening of congenital diseases, and so on. It's all there in the PGIM prospectus if you decide that pathology suits you for the rest of your life. So the work setting, if you choose to be a pathologist, you'll be in a lab doing cutting up of the specimens that the surgeon sent you, or doing FNAs at the FNAC clinics and looking at the slides. If you would choose hematology, you'll be performing bone marrows or you'll be managing bleeding disorders and so on. And chemical pathology deals mostly in the lab. They have to stay mostly in the lab running these very high flown enzyme assays and so on. So what are the eligibility criteria? Mandatory is an MBBS. If your MBBS is from a foreign country, then it should be registered at the SLMC. Then internship and a post-intern period of 1 year for histopathology. But if you choose hematology or chemical pathology, the post-intern period should include 6 months of adult medicine or pediatrics, or a post-intern period of 1 year in clinical disciplines such as ward setting, ICU, or anesthesia. So curriculum is all there again in the PGIM. I'm just giving you a summary of it. There's a screening exam, and then you have a continuous assessment. And at the end of 2 years, you have the MD part one. At the end of 4 years, you have MD part two, 1 year of local training, 1 year of overseas training, after which you will be board certified as a consultant pathologist. So One disadvantage is it's a long course. You can see that. So for the screening exam, you have an MCQ paper and an SCQ paper. Again, everything is there in the prospectus. And these are the approximate pass rates of our screening exam. So these are, you know, the pink columns are the ones that have passed. So it's approximately 30 to 50% pass rate overall. What about the MD part two? The pass rates have not been that good. After about 2011, we have put brakes on because of the implications of wrong diagnosis. So it has gone down a little after these years. But for hematology, it's not so bad. It has maintained its pass rates. And for chemical pathology, it's almost 100%. So those are the pass rates in the exams. So what about the CADA? Ministry of CADA has about 60 odd pathologists spread all over the country, and about nearly one third of that is in the university departments and about one in the military hospital. So this is the breakdown of the pathologists. And across the country, this is the distribution. You can see the highest numbers are spread in the western, central, and the southern provinces, with a few in the other provinces. So currently, this is the situation in the country. So the CADA projection for 2020 was this. So we need a lot. There is a huge dearth of histopathologists compared to the other two specialities, because there has to be a histopathologist at centers where there is a surgeon. So the numbers, there are a lot of vacant positions in histopathology. So what are the advantages? It's a challenging job. We have good working hours. Emergencies are less in histopathology and chemical pathology, but not so in hematology, where they get some emergencies in leukemias and so on. There are many vacant positions, and the foreign training is good. There are jobs abroad for all. Disadvantage being the patient contact, that is especially for histopathology, but that is not that much felt now with the other MDTs and things going on. The postgraduate course is obviously long, it's 6 years, and the private practice income again will depend on how good the pathologist you are. So depending, it's not as good as a surgeon, but obviously, but you, if you are good at what you do, you can earn your private practice. And another hazard is that you're always at the mic if you do histopathology, so your physical exercise may not be good. So thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Gulani Venerama.
Any questions?
Yeah, there are a couple of questions for you, Gulani. First one is, from where we can get past MCQs and SCQs in pathology?
You can see the PGIM past papers. You can go to the PGIM site, and then if you click on the past papers, you can get past papers. MCQs are not available on the web, but SCQs are available. Yes.
Yeah. And the next question is, are there any teaching programs for selection exam for pathology? When will be the next selection exam for pathology?
We are not having selection exams currently. We are not running any selection exam, but the recommended textbook is Robbins, Pathologic Basis of Disease, which is the undergraduate book that we recommend. That is the one that you need for histopathology, for mainly, and Hofbrand for hematology.
One more question. How the candidates are divided into subspecialities? Is it depending on the marks or not?
Depending on the selection exam, and depends on the cadres available for the. We usually get a sort of a breakdown from the ministry. So depending on that, and depending on the performance, it's based on merit. So depending on the positions, the merit positions are given to the according to the specialities from the screening exam itself.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Dhulni Bhairagama, for educating us on pathology.